lights are out, green flag in hand. We're going to try to do it one more time in a turn four. Dan Dabo will lead the field to the green flag. Turn three, here comes a 37 to Rob Mayo.
Headbangers and lather!
He clears Elliott, he is your new leader, Rob Mayo.
Sparks flying in the dead of the night!
And look at the big move by Campos in
it.
Flag is out.
50,000 watts of power.
Look at the response of that safety team.
And it's pushing overload.
Our extreme fire and rescue, the best in the business.
The beast is ready to devour.
Live from the AMCO Total Car Care Studio in Corvallis, Oregon, you're listening to Northwest Dirt News on Spreaker Radio.
Welcome. It is another time, another night for Northwest Dirt News here on Spreaker Radio from the AMCO Total Car Care Center in Corvallis. In the studio tonight with Mr. Sam Pettit and Handsome Dom. All kinds of stuff going on. It's a little warm in the studio tonight. Definitely got some heat up in here. I'm a little loud. There we go. Adjustments are there. Okay, so we've got things going on here. It's been kind of hectic around here. You guys are back to full staff. Things are hopping and bopping. You guys... just closed the doors as we were arriving to get this thing set up, and man, you guys are super busy around AMCO.
Yeah, the hot weather brings everybody out. Luckily, we got it all in before Friday in the rain, but yeah, it's been a really good week. The full staff, got some new guys, really good guys. Everything's going smooth.
Good deal. And Sam, your week's been all right?
It's over. That's all I care about.
His work week is over. Sam's a little moody today. He's been in one of those Sam Pettit fight mode moods. He's kind of like the dual personality there from the movie Fight Club. You got to be careful with him today.
I got some snacks.
I see snacks.
It's been a crazy week. I know. I don't know if you guys were aware, but there was actually a race last weekend.
And an awesome race at that.
Incredible race. And we're going to talk about that tonight. We're going to talk about Cottage Grove. We're going to talk about some Bakersfield news. We're going to talk about all kinds of cool stuff. But first and foremost, I want to welcome a new member to the Moxie Media and Promotions team. You got to turn that off. Speaking of our newest member, Brian Smith, Bakersfield Speedway announcer, working alongside of Mike Patterson. Brian, are you there, sir? Hold on 1 second. Brian, are you there?
Yes, I can hear you. What's up? How's it going? I'm doing fantastic. Yeah, I can hear you. are you gonna blow a fuse or what?
How about now?
Okay. Can you hear me now?
Can you hear me now? That's the question. I want to know if you can hear me.
I've been hearing you since we started talking.
Okay, so right now everybody's saying all they can hear is you. Why?
Oh, really?
Why is this?
I don't know. You tell me.
Yeah, well, it's... Okay, we're there. We're there. Brian, we got you.
All right, cool.
So, again, man, welcome to the team, bro. It is not this bad all the time, I promise.
Okay.
Yeah. There's so many little buttons here you got to push, and if one of them gets pushed, then it's it really screws up everything, and you got to go through and redo the settings, which is what I just did when I was saying, can you hear me now? So, newest member to the Moxie team, working side-by-side with Mike Patterson down there at Bakersfield Speedway. How's things going down there?
Good, really good. We beginning the season kind of sad because we got rained out three races in a row, but now we're back to racing. We're going.
Well, you guys are working on your fourth or fifth race or fifth or sixth race already. We've had one, Mike, and we're going to be raining out again this weekend. I'm telling you.
Wow, that sucks.
That is how the Northwest works every year in the springtime. Right, guys? I mean, it's just one of those deals where...
Well, it's a hit or miss.
It is. It is. Unlike Bakersfield, it gets all the beautiful sunshine. And you guys have had a pretty weird year yourself down there.
Yeah, it's this year awful crazy. The first three races of the season, unfortunately got rained out. But our opening night was with the World of Outlaws, which is really exciting. So, and being with Mike for the first time in Mox Media, and it's been a roller coaster. But right now we're really starting to gel.
Absolutely. And I know that you guys are going to be a great team down there at Bakersfield, having to work together the last couple of years doing the Budweiser Nationals. There's no doubt you and Mike are going to make a great team and definitely improve Moxie Media, especially with our racing news from the Southwest area down there in Bakersfield and the surrounding area.
Oh, most definitely.
I know that he's excited to be working next to you and the Mike Mosier Tower, the legendary Mike Mosier, where, you know, we got to – call him a friend before he passed, and I know you worked with him quite a bit in other capacities there at the Speedway and got to learn a lot from him. And if you can be half of what Mike ever was, I think any of us would be really, really good at our positions as announcers.
I tell you, Mike was kind of like an icon to Bakersfield Speedway, and to watch him as a kid growing up and now sit where he sat. And when Scott came to me and asked me to do this, I don't even consider it a job because I love it so much.
No doubt about it. And we do have fun doing it, and to get paid is just it's icing on the cake.
Yeah.
So, World of Outlaws night, you guys had a huge turnout down there at Bakersfield, not a seat left in the house, and you had almost 50-some-odd sprint cars show up?
Yeah, they had more than what they had in 2016, I believe, and I don't think they really expected that many cars. Plus, there were several races that got rained out, like Tulare got rained out. Another race up north got rained out, so more guys from the California swing decided to show up, and I think it was a little surprising to everybody.
Good deal. That's always good for the fans, and sprint car fans are pretty diehard. They get a little rowdy down there. How'd the show go for you guys?
It went really well. You know, it's your usual show with the World of Outlaws. You know, it's high paced, real fast, and just a lot of fun. I tell you, I always like it when they come to town because it brings a lot of people to Bakersfield, gives Bakersfield a lot of, you know, how would you say it, just fans in general. Because that's all people know is the World of Outlaws. But now, if they come to Bakersfield Speedway, you know, there's people that come for the World of Outlaws that didn't even know Bakersfield Speedway was in Bakersfield. And a lot of people I work with don't know it's there. So basically, that's what we're trying to do. We're trying to get Bakersfield Speedway out there more so more people know where this track is in Bakersfield. It's been here for 73 years now.
Yeah, at 73 years, that track's been... Wow. In action, and the racing down there is phenomenal. I'm going to tell you, like I've told these guys here, the rest of the Moxie team, I love going down there and watching your hobby stock division, your American stocks. To me, everybody loves the late models and the modifieds. They're big, fast, they're loud, they're nasty, they're great entertainment, but nothing beats those hobby stock and American stock divisions down there at the Bud Nationals. I have to watch those races when I'm there.
Yeah, another question a lot of people have been asking that, why couldn't Scott add the mini stocks? I mean, that would be a really good class too, but I'm not sure if he would do that. But I mean, that would be a seller because look what we get on a weekly night. We get between, you figure the last two weekends we've raced them, we've had B mains. You're looking up almost 30 mini stocks.
Right. Yeah. And that's a great, another great entry level class down there. You guys draw a lot of cars with, well, I think those, what makes those American stocks so intriguing to me is these are cars that you look at that look like the Novas, and they look like the, you know, whatever you're looking at. Well, I mean, you can tell what it is, what you're looking at. But those cars, what makes, I think, is very unique to me is they have to run a DOT street tire.
Yeah, remember we seen the four-door Malibus and they all had regular old white letter tires you buy at the Les Schwab or whatever,
Is it? Do you know why? Is that just a cost thing they do down there at Bakersfield, Brian?
I think so. I think it's just a cost thing, and it kind of keeps the class kind of equal.
It keeps it a lot equal because those cars, those guys get in the crowd and start racing. It's phenomenal. I absolutely love watching those cars on that unique surface that you guys have down there, that clay that comes off the grapevine. It's impressive how that track changes and the racing that surface creates. I mean, we were all excited last year watching that.
Yeah. Yeah, well, that night they were showing us how they groove tires differently, things of that nature, but all in all, the tire is still the same.
It's a street tire, yeah. And man, these guys. But here's the thing about that Bud Nationals race, and Brian will testify to this too. These guys show up for the Bud Nationals, and every one of those cars, 99% of them at least, all had brand new sets of tires on those cars. And these guys, they're racers. Just because they're on street tires, those are race cars, okay?
Sure.
What I also thought was pretty cool was you look at those cars, and Dom, you and I caught on to this pretty quick. The right side tires, a little taller than the left side, all the way down.
Well,
those guys are making these cars turn.
But I don't want to get off topic here, but you think that tire is still $100.
Right.
And what's the G60
cost? Yeah.
Right.
So the cost efficiency, I don't think, is there. I think it's
more
of an equality.
You're saving a little. You're saving, what, $20-$30?
Yeah, but... All in all.
But that street tire is going to limit what you can do with whatever's under that hood.
Yeah, because they certainly aren't G60s.
Right, right. And I will tell you, going down there, there's a bunch of those cars I like, but one of the drivers in particular that I really like to watch just because is that Nick Johnson kid.
Oh, yeah.
Remember Nick Johnson,
I do.
The 1J? He won the Bud Nationals 2 years ago, right, Brian?
Yeah.
And he was, what, 14 years old when he won it?
Yeah.
Yeah, he also won the Nationals over in Santa Maria, too.
This kid's a race car driver.
He is.
He is an awesome race car driver. But and his dad races too. Correct?
Yes, Chad Johnson's dad.
Right, and those guys. Correct me if I'm wrong. Are those guys driving a Cadillac race car?
Yeah, it's probably like a '76 or '78 Cadillac Seville.
It's no joke. They're using Cadillacs, and they're faster. It's crazy.
The funny thing is the Cadillacs came in like 2 or 3 years ago down here. Everybody was wanting to run Cadillacs, and then it was Novas, and then it was this, because it's got to be a certain amount of – it's got to be like 180-inch wheelbase or something like that. So,
right.
And it's got to be a certain year. It can't be anything newer. It can't be under that 180-inch wheelbase.
Which I think is cool because of the type of cars that you see.
Well, you think about it, the Cadillac is going to be based off of a Impala chassis,
right.
So
right.
It's
yep.
really
or Caprice.
Yeah.
Or
Caprice.
And another thing is why they probably run that is because it's not a unibody or a uniframe, and it's probably a full subframe underneath, so it's a lot better, sturdier, stronger.
Yeah, and a lot of them come with over 400 cubic inch engines.
Yeah.
No doubt.
Yeah.
No doubt.
I mean, I've known. Go ahead.
What I love about those cars is you look at them; they have the sheet metal bodies.
Yeah.
But you can still tell what they are, like the 91 car and the 26
sure.
and the 1J. I mean, you look at these cars and you know that that's a Nova, that's a Camaro, that's a Chevelle, that's
kind of like a modified. Used to look something like a Pinto or something like a
Gremlin right?
And now they kind of just look like a car of some sort. Yeah.
But it's an awesome thing to watch, and it's funny to me to go down to the Bud Nationals, which is a big race.
Yeah.
I mean, Brian, correct me. Am I right when I say that last year there was 265 cars in attendance at the Budweiser Nationals?
Oh, yeah. There'll probably be more this year, maybe.
I would not doubt it because every year I go there, that race gets bigger and bigger and bigger, and the pits get – I mean, it gets pretty crowded out there, and that's a huge pit area at Bakersfield.
Yeah, that was awesome.
A lot of
people, they try to put that race on their bucket list. They try to make it to that Budweiser Nationals. I mean, that's why when we socialize with people on Facebook, like I got a couple of guys that came all the way from up Santa Rosa, the first time they ever been here, and they run Sport Mods, and they say, man, we're coming back to the Budweiser Nationals, so we'll probably get them guys, So that's what I try to keep a good rapport with the drivers, and then when they come here, give them a lot of, give them, welcome them to the track, greet them and all that, and let them know, hey, thanks for coming. We appreciate it because what's going to happen next time? They're going to come back.
There's no doubt about it. And you want
to
talk about
– forward to doing.
Yeah. You want to talk about incredible racing at the Bud Nationals? Dom, you know where I'm going.
Oh, my gosh.
We're going Sport Mods. The Sport Mods, I think, as a race fan sitting in the stands, probably off